We'll turn the mic on, we hope. Everyone in this audience shops at Whole Foods, and don't even try to deny it. In my own Jamaica Plain, a neighborhood of Boston, Massachusetts, a few years ago, Whole Foods decided to come in, as it turns out, down the street from Walter's brother, a neighbor, and the 2 years of community protests that greeted it. How awful that you're going to bring up property values in the neighborhood. We hate you. The main reason being because Jamaica Plain had been a mixed neighborhood. There was great concern about what would happen to the lower income people who might be priced out from what would otherwise be viewed as a salubrious development for the neighborhood. It was fascinating to watch this because it was really, at least in Jamaica Plain, and we're going to talk about other conflicts, we're now going to go right into Detroit, but in Jamaica Plain at least, it was largely extremely well-meaning liberal food people like myself who were saying, please think about the consequences, please think about the Latino produce, because it had been a Latino market in the space that you were going That's into, right. And you must think of preserving this neighborhood. Mayor Menino of Boston made sure that there would be bodegas, and in fact, the Whole Foods itself has a huge Latino produce area. But when I would talk to people, I've lived there for a while, and then I would talk to people who'd lived there 35 years as urban pioneers when it was extremely dangerous to live there, they would say, we're counting the minutes till Whole Foods opens. There's this great conflict and dichotomy about everything Whole Foods represents now. Just now when we were talking about the fact that Whole Foods is about to open in a poor neighborhood of Chicago, Englewood,
right.
There's tremendous attention to this. And someone directly challenged Mr. Robb and said, well, how do you expect anyone to be able to afford to shop there? So, Detroit. How does anyone afford to shop there, and what was your idea in going into Detroit, Chicago, and now a third store like that?
Well, good morning, everybody. Let me start with three ideas. Number one is there is a disparity of food access in this country that is startling and stunning and is morally repugnant. There are 6,500 communities in this nation that do not have access to fresh food in the way that many of you do and take for granted. Number two, is there an idea that accompanying a community, there's an ideology around what that looks like and how those conversations goes and needs to be challenged and changed, and in that change creates real new possibility for all sorts of communities, whether it's us or any other company, I believe can happen. Number three, this idea of diversion and inclusion and cultural diversity and the idea of cultural relevance matters in these conversations in ways that I don't think gets the attention it deserves. So in Detroit, for example, I think we just really started with, instead of saying we're coming, we started with a year worth of conversation, at the invitation, by the way, of the Secretary of Agriculture and some other folks in the community who said, would you please take a look? We do not have food access in this community. You know the story of Detroit, 2 million people down to 700,000 people, a city flat on its back. And yet, when I went there as an entrepreneur, for many years, seeing the community in the making. Mm-hmm. And so we started with a year's worth of conversation. What's important to you? What matters with you? Respecting and meeting people where they were. So to open the store, by the time we got to the decision to announce the store, we took another year and a half to build it out. And during that time, we had a conversation with the community. There was a group, an activist group that was formed that challenged us on hiring, on investment, on all these sorts of areas. So as a result, and we took them on a bus out to the Oakland County stores, had them give us feedback on what worked and didn't work. Ultimately, we evolved our business model. The costs are obviously much lower there. We lowered our gross margin, lowered our prices, broadened our selection, and as a result, I think we've been able to give some choices to the community that they haven't had heretofore.
I wonder if in Detroit there was the same. In Jamaica Plain, there were many calls for Whole Foods to begin a subsidized housing fund for the people who would be displaced by the higher income. Was there such an idea in Detroit? I mean, did you have calls like that? You have to make good by actually paying people money for the increased property values.
So here's the issues at surface: racism, elitism, and gentrification. All issues that are somehow not being examined really at a deeper level, mm-hmm. that really need to be if these things are going to be met, these challenges are going to be met. So yes, people challenge us around that. The best way to go at that is to start again by respecting people where they are, respecting the fact that there's a community there. You are joining a community. You are not a white stork dropping in with some sort of great regalia from heaven. You are joining a community that's already in formation. In the case of Detroit, I mean, this is an iconic American city. So you start with a respect for that, and I've honestly forgotten your question. I'm so sorry.
Did anyone?
But I got kind of wound up there.
Did anyone in Detroit say, "Build us"?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. They did. They said because we're concerned about what's going to happen to housing, and they started to create, you know, and that was the first. You know, I can tell you that conversation is a little different in Chicago than it was in Detroit because we didn't really know what we were doing, and the conversation surfaced more after the store was open as people began to see, okay, what's happening with housing? There were some developers that were moving folks out of fixed income housing, and the units were beginning to change, and I could see that while they didn't lay it at our feet, they did say our coming in was that a change. So we should talk about gentrification. We should talk about the fact that neighborhoods do change, and how are we going to talk about that conversation differently than just saying, okay, Whole Foods comes in, it's gentrification. There's a deeper cut at that conversation. Do you want to do that now? Or?
I'd like to do some of it, and I'd like to say, pull us back from, you had a year of conversation before you
we
went
did.
To Detroit. You
we
wanted
did.
This cultural sensitivity or understanding the
yeah.
people there better. Same thing with Jamaica Plain. I mean, it was like you were forced into that conversation. But you didn't tell us why you wanted to go. Jamaica Plain is not an underserved neighborhood, whatever people would like to believe about the way it was. You were going into literally underserved neighborhoods, as you will be doing Englewood. What's behind that decision in the first place?
You know, honestly, at this point, I've been doing this over 30 years, and, you know, our mission as a company, and we started out when no one really knew what natural food was, is to bring healthier food to the world. That's why we did it then. That's why we're doing it now. And at some point, with this particular skill set we have as a company, this idea that if you look at the life expectancy in Detroit, it is 12 years less in the city than outside of the city. If you look at the statistics in Englewood and Chicago, where we're headed now, 8 years less. This is Chicago Public Health Department statistics. That is human potential. And for me as a grocer, at some point it's a moral question, it's a moral challenge. How can it be? We didn't start in business to serve some communities. We didn't say we're going to serve healthy food for some people. The mission is to serve people healthier. Whether it's us or any other grocers, I want to see that change. I want to see access to healthier food change. So for me, for Whole Foods, it's about fulfilling our greater mission in the world.
I think a lot of people have the idea that you'll go into a very underserved neighborhood, you'll cure the food desert. It's like a mirage. It's like a vision of the gates of paradise, but in fact, no one will be able to afford it. And you will actually be bleeding them dry of their almost non-existent disposable income with your extortionate prices. So what do you answer to that?
How do you really feel about that? How I answer that is this. First of all, Detroit's now been open for 16 months, and I will tell you that, you know, it's the greatest standard I set for that store is I like to be able to walk in that store 16 months later and feel the community in the store, feel that we're serving the broader community. That's what we set out to do there. And I think we're succeeding so far. And so the fact is it's a voluntary decision. People do not have to shop there. They can choose to shop there or not. I think they see it as being something very positive. So the evidence is in, at least in that community, that people like what they see. They find it affordable. They're able to use it. Our food stamp usage in that store is 6 times the company average. So again, suggesting that we're having a higher penetration.
Is that 6 times 0?
No, it's not. No.
What was food stamp usage in the other stores?
I'm not playing funny with you here. Seriously, we haven't given out those numbers just because we're a public company. You've got to be careful with those sorts of things. No, our company, we do take food stamps, and food stamps are redeemed. But in this particular store in Detroit, and also in New Orleans, by the way, the usage is 6 times what happens in the rest of the country. I'm simply pointing out that the broader community is being served. Yes, we've lowered prices. We've broadened our selection. We've played much more. You know, we've used this as an opportunity to learn about how to take our quality standards, which we have not compromised in the offering, by the way, and it's the same quality food that's offered at any Whole Foods, and make it affordable selectively in different areas by making sure that they have the better range of choices, and that's what we're doing.
Did you actually, I love SNAP, and I love SNAP usage, so I'm completely glad to hear about that. Did you have to change any of your internal accounting systems to accommodate an anticipated rise in SNAP usage?
No, we didn't have to do that. We expected it to be greater. We didn't expect it to be at the 6-7 time level. But I tell you, the program we cannot crack is WIC. And WIC is another program for nursing mothers.
Women
and you'd think that you'd think that you could get that program to work as well. But it's so rigid as to only certain brands are accepted. And we cracked that. We went to the Secretary Vilsack. We went to the state of Michigan, and we just could not get through it. So as a result, we are not able to to crack that program. But the food stamp program, we're able to do that. And of course, you're familiar with the Double Bucks efforts in a number of communities where...
It started in Boston with Wholesome, the Wholesome Way Foundation. It's
Michelle,
a way
Michelle.
Bounty Bucks double the value of food stamps that are used for fresh produce.
That's exactly right. So, and what they found is that the sort of suggestion was, well, they won't buy fresh produce. Well, the data is now in from, this is the Fair Food Network in Ann Arbor, Michigan.
Mm-hmm.
It's really done the best data
Orrin
work.
Hesterman.
It's all up on the web, Orrin Hesterman, that the data shows very clearly that with those incentives in place, the produce usage goes crazy. So they do buy it. So it's, there it is.
Well, that's great that you're going to these neighborhoods. Isn't it part of a much broader push toward kind of smaller stores, more geared to neighborhoods?
I wouldn't call it a broader push. I mean, we build all size stores all over. So we have 400 stores now. We're building another 41 this next year. This is part of an effort really around pushing ourselves into the inner city communities to try to make a contribution. I'm under no illusion that we're the solution, but I think that our efforts have been contributory towards a better environment. I think it's encouraged other companies to come there. And I hope that this sort of idea of how a company thinks about coming to a community, I think it has huge potential. So this idea of respecting and meeting people where they are, recognizing that you're joining a community that's already in process, and you thinking about it differently, what your responsibilities are in that joining. And I'm passionate about that because this is what's happening right now in New Orleans when we've done our store there, in Mid-City, Broad and Bienville, and also in Englewood, which is, everybody know Englewood in the south side of Chicago? I mean, the south side of Chicago, and the mayor has done a fantastic job focusing on these questions of food access through his increased farmers markets, changing...
We're allowed to name him here.
My friend and your friend, Rahm Emanuel, has done a very wonderful job. He personally called me and asked if Whole Foods would come to the south side of Chicago. That's how involved he is. And he's done some great innovative policy things with farmers markets, with bus stops, with urban gardens, with repurposing newsstands to be fresh produce, with mobile buses. All this is happening under his watch. He's brought a number of grocers to the south side. It's amazing if you go to Chicago, the north side, and we're there, lots of choices. South side, no choices. And I will tell you that one of the community meetings, and I think I shared this with you, I'm sitting there with a number of the community members, and one of them looks at me and says, Walter, and there's around the table, Walter, we want some of the choices that other communities have. He looks at me. This is Reverend Bishop Dukes. He looks at me and he says, Walter, lift us up. Lift us up. And again, I'm a grocer, but here's the thing, is you're talking about human potential. You're talking about human spirit. So look, we're just part of something that happened. I'm saying to you, there's 6,500 areas in the United States that need some sort of additional access, whether it's us or anybody else, and need some new, fresh thinking about companies' responsibilities. Communities, by the way, have to shift too, because they'll sit down and they'll look at you and they'll say, you guys are trouble. You guys are not going to do this right. You guys, you know, sign a benefits agreement because we don't trust you. And that's what I realized in the first meeting in Detroit, that I looked across the table, there was no trust. And without the currency of trust, there is no possibility. Unless you're willing to change how you think. So you go ahead.
I'm asking another trust question, which is apart from all these fascinating questions we've been talking about. Trust in how the produce has been raised and the fairness and equity to workers. There are many systems that I personally am fascinated by, rating systems, mm-hmm. and welfare standards.
Yes.
But Whole Foods has decided to go it alone and kind of create your own system of standards. And just 2 weeks ago,
that's right.
you released something, and I wanted to ask you about that and why you decided essentially to create your own rather than going with any other established criteria.
Well, because there simply is no standards for conventional produce in this country. There's nothing that exists. And so you buy organic produce or you buy conventional produce, what is that? You don't even know what it means. You have no transparency, no visibility into how that produce has been raised, including where it's been raised offshore and how it's been raised there. And we know from many reports that the usage of pesticides is far more indiscriminate overseas than it is here. And so this system called Responsibly Grown Produce, which we did announce, is a full transparency into domestic produce, and it is, you can read all about it on the web, that sort of thing, but it gives you a much wider view into how it's being raised. We have 65% of our growers now on that portal, and it's a broader sustainability index. So for the first time, the customer, you, going to JP, which I hope you are, When you look at this, it'll be rated good, better, best. You can track the standards there, and you'll have that sort of visibility into the product that you're buying. And we did eliminate the most noxious organophosphate chemicals that are in the dirty dozen, so to speak. Those have been eliminated. Six or seven of them have been eliminated in this go-round. If you want to get the ranking, those things have been related to child disorders and that sort of thing. And the neonicotides have been related to bee calling disorder. So there's some concerns out there that I think this system begins to really address. Plus the transparency. Ultimately, what do you got to hide? If you're selling something, be clear and be visible, be accountable for it.
Well, we are grateful to you because whatever Whole Foods does, the rest of us in this world have to watch very carefully. It influences everyone else in the community. Thanks for sharing some of it with us, and we're going to keep watching.
Thank you to Walter Robb and the great Corby Kummer.